Now, today we'll talk about the failover clustering. The second part of clustering is known as failover clustering. Okay, so I already talked about the clustering. Clustering is what it's a process. Okay, through it's a process. It is used to. It gives you two types of clustering. Okay, number one, NLB clustering, and number second is failover clustering. Now, if we talk about the failover clustering means that it provides high availability. Okay, it provides you high availability solution. So it means that if you have a multiple servers who provide the same resources, like we talk about the file servers in the previous classes. So web servers in the previous classes. So if you have a web servers, if we have more than one web servers in our network, if my one web server is down, the second web server provides the same resources. Okay. Now, what is the difference between failover and NLB is that in NLB, all the servers are running at the same time. Okay. All the servers are running in the same time. But if we talk about the failover, so in failover, what we have, like this is my network. Okay. In that, imagine that I have file servers. Okay. You know that what is file server? File server is used to maintain the files, share files and folders. Okay. So like imagine that I have two file servers. File server one. We have file server one. Okay. And we have a file server two. Okay. Now file server two takes the backup of file server one, as you can say that. Okay. So now what happens in that case? I have some clients. Like imagine I have 500 clients in my network, okay, who regularly access these file servers. 500 clients I have who regularly access these file servers and access their data, their files, their resources, okay, with the help of this file server. Now imagine that. Now in that, I want that, okay. Now right now these two file servers are running at the same time. I want that, okay. I want to go for high availability in that case. What I do, I want that. First, my file server one is active, okay, and my file server two I want in standby mode, okay. Once my if my active server is down, okay, if my active file server is down, okay, so standby server automatically become active and provide the same resources to the client, like this. So that's what we can use for failover clustering. So in failover clustering, if you have, imagine 10 servers, so only one server is running at a time. All nine servers are in standby mode. Okay. Once if my active server is down, so one of the standby servers automatically become active and provide the same resources, like this. Okay. Like this, what we have a failover clustering. Okay. Now, if we talk about the failover clustering, if I need to implement failover clustering in my network, okay, so what I need first, I need failover clustering storage. So number one, what I need failover clustering storage. Okay. We have a failover clustering storage. Okay, so now, so we need one failover clustering storage as well, like in talk about the NLB. So I don't want any storage to implement the NLB, but if I need to implement the failover clustering, so we need a failover clustering storage. So what kind of storage we need? A SAN server. In that, we need a SAN storage. So I hope both of you know the SAN storage. We talk about previous lectures also, the DAS, NAS, SAN. Three types of file servers, three type of storage we have. Okay, so Sai Teja and Teja, I hope you remember SAN storage, right? We already did the practical as well, right? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we need a SAN storage over there. For SAN storage, what we need for SAN storage, we need same the iSCSI services, iSCSI. Target services. Okay, we need iSCSI target server to implement the SAN server, okay, to a dedicated machine, okay. In that we can use iSCSI as a protocol, okay. Next, we need a fiber channel for this. We need a fiber channel because I already told you your SAN works with fiber optic cables and fiber channels. So we need dedicated storage, as you can see that. Okay, so we have a dedicated storage as well. Okay, so we need a dedicated storage as well. Okay, to implement the SAN storage. Okay, so what we need, if I need to implement the failover clustering, so what we need a one separate server who working as a SAN. Okay, so this server, you can see that it's working as a SAN server. Okay, and with the help and with this server, I can attach one storage as well. Okay, or you can say that I can attach storage with this server. So imagine that this is my storage. Okay, and with the help of fiber optic cables and fiber channels, we connect this storage with this SAN server like this. Okay, so this is your storage like this. Okay, storage rack we have. You have a storage rack like this. Okay, and this rack attached with the fiber optic cables. This is the fiber optic cables and channels we have. And fiber channel we need. Like this. Okay. So these are the fiber optic cable and we need fiber channels to connect this this SAN server to the storage. Okay, like we have a physical storage, as you can say that. Okay, so in live organizations, we have a physical storage. Okay, so this is what we need. First, we need a failover cluster storage we have. Okay, number second, what we need in this, if we talk about the hardware configuration, okay, if we talk about the hardware configuration, so number second in that, all the servers who participate in one cluster should have same hardware. Okay, like imagine that if I am using over there Intel processor, okay, AMD motherboard like this, so your server's hardware should be same. Your server hardware configuration should be same. Okay, if you want to add all the servers in one cluster, so your server hardware should be same. Remember these things. Okay, fine. Number third, like if one server has a 2 LAN card, so every server has a 2 LAN card. If one server has 8 GB of RAM, so every server has 8 GB of RAM, like this. Okay, now we talk about the network requirements for failover clustering implementation. So Microsoft told you that you need at least 2 LAN cards. Okay, one for your clustering network, one for a failover clustering network, and one for a private network. But we need, you can say that we need a minimum 1 LAN card in every server. Remember these things also. Okay, because why Microsoft told you that you need 2 LAN cards, because the Microsoft tells you that when you implement the failover clustering, so we need at least we have at least a separate cluster network, because if my main network is down, so it does not impact with the cluster network, as you can say that. Okay, so that's why Microsoft recommends you that you have at least 2 LAN cards to every servers. Okay, fine, but we can go for a minimum one LAN card as well. It doesn't matter that you can go for a different network. Okay, number second in that, we need minimum 1 LAN card, and number second, all the servers has permanent IP address. You confirm that your server IP address not be changed. Okay, so we're not able to use DHCP in this. Okay, all servers have as you can see that permanent IP address. We need permanent IP address. Okay, all servers have permanent IP address, as you can see that. If any server has IP address changed, so that has issues with them. Okay, so that's why we can call all servers have permanent IP address. So we need a permanent IP address to all the servers. Okay, so that's why we're not able to use DHCP. Okay, because if DHCP provides IP address to the server, like imagine if my server is down or my server is restarted, so DHCP sometimes change the IP address. So it doesn't. So it's not good in the clustering. Okay. So what we need, all servers have permanent IP address, means we need to define the IP address statically to all the servers, that the IP address not change. Okay. So this is what we have. Okay. This is the basic requirements of our failover. Okay. Fine. Now next we talk about the Active Directory requirements for failover clustering. So I'll open the next paint. Now we talk about the infrastructure requirement. So number one, what we need Active Directory domain services. Okay, we need AdS. Okay, we need AdS. We need Active Directory domain controllers as well. Okay, AdS. And domain controllers, as you can say that. Okay, and your domain controller, your DC should be run on Windows Server 2008 or above. Okay, so we need AdS and we need domain controllers, and your domain controller should be run on Windows Server 2008. Okay, not less than that. Windows 2003 is not supported in failover clustering. So right now 2003 is not there, means the Microsoft is not supported 2003 right now. So that's why we need at least 2008 servers. Okay, if you want to implement failover clustering. Okay, number second, domain functional level. Domain functional level and forest functional level. Functional level should be run on Windows Server 2008 or above. Okay, so domain function level and the follow function level should be run on for Windows Server 2008, not less than that. Okay, so if you imagine that if I set my forest function level on 2008, it means that I'm able to use 2008 server onwards. I am able to use 2008, 12, 16, 19, all those servers. Okay, if I set the function level in domain function, domain also same to Server 2008. So it means that in that present domain network, I'm able to use 2008, 2012, 16, 19 servers. Okay. Like this, fine. So this is mandatory. Okay. Now, if you work on 2019 server, okay. So number third requirement is that whenever application or whenever services you want to enable on failover clustering, or whatever services you want to enable on failover clustering, okay, your services should be support this feature. You can say that if you using the application. Application must support Windows Server 2019 high availability. Okay, the application must support Windows Server 2019 high availability. Whatever application you can on, like right now I'm using doing failover clustering on file servers. So your file server should be a support Windows Server 2019 high availability feature. Okay, fine. So this is what we have. Okay. And the edit, and very important thing is that all servers who are participate in failover clustering must have same server edition and service pack. This is the important thing. Okay, like imagine if I'm using in one server, I'm using server 2019 enterprise edition. Okay, sorry, data center edition. And in second server, I can using Windows Server 2019 standard edition. So it's not working. Okay, all the servers should have the same edition. If I'm using the data center edition, so all server has data center edition. If I'm using the standard edition, so all server has standard edition. Okay, so this is what we have. Okay, these are the major, you can say that these are the major requirements you need to fulfill. Okay, before you implement the failover clustering. Okay, so this is what we have. Number one, failover clustering storage should be there. All servers who participate in one cluster should have same hardware. We need minimum one LAN card in every server. All server has permanent IP address, means manually IP address, statically IP address defined on all the servers. Okay, we're not able to use DHCP. Number fifth, infrastructure requirements, we need ADS and DC should be run on Windows Server 2008 or above servers. Domain function level and fault function level should be run on Windows Server 2008 or above. Application must support Windows Server 2019 high availability. And all the servers who are participate in failover clustering must have same server edition and service pack. So these are the requirements, you can say that, in failover clustering. Okay. Now the next thing we need to understand is, both of you understand till now, Sai, Teja and Teja? Till now, I hope you will understand these things now.
Right? Yes, sir, I understand.
Okay. So now, great. Now we have another thing we need to failover clustering is known as Coorum. Coorum. Coorum disk. This is the you can say that Coorum is a functionality, is a clustering functionality, as you can say that. Okay. So if you talk about the Coorum, so what Coorums do? Coorum is a kind of disk, you can say that, who maintains the information about clustering. Okay, Coorum decides that, like imagine if I have 10 servers in one cluster, like imagine my server one is up and rest all server nine all rest servers are in standby mode. Now imagine that my server one is active. Now imagine that server one is down automatically. So which server is up? Who decide that? The Coorum disk is decide. And out of nine, which server is up now? Okay, fine. So we have a Coorum modes, as you can see that. Coorum disk is used, it is used to maintain the clustering information, as you can see that. Okay, it is used to maintain the clustering information. Okay, and all the decisions are based on, all the decisions are taken by a Coorum disk, as you can see that in the clustering. Okay, now Coorum has modes. Coorum disk has mode. So it's not a hardware disk. We create Coorum disk. Okay, it's not a hardware disk. We create Coorum disk. Okay, so I'll let you know when we go for practical. Okay, how we can create the Coorum disk. So then we have a Coorum modes also. Okay, if we talk about the Coorum modes, so I'll start with number one. You can call it's known as node majority. Okay, node majority. So in this, node majority works like, imagine node majority works when more than half of the servers in the cluster are online. Okay, so it means that node majority, first mode is node majority. In this, that what happens, like imagine if I have 10, I'm using the 10 servers. Okay, I create one cluster and I can add all 10 servers in one cluster. Okay, like what happens in that case? Like imagine out of 10, 6 servers are suddenly off, or 6 servers are automatically, or suddenly you can see that switch off. It's not working, 6 servers. So what happens in that case? If more than 50 servers are offline, so what happens? The cluster is automatically shut down in that case. Okay, so node majority works on the works, you can say that, on the base of servers which we added. Okay, so if your half of the server is online, your cluster is running. Once if imagine that if your half of the servers are offline in the cluster, so your cluster is automatically shut down. Remember these things. Okay, clear? So this is what we have, a node majority. Okay, understand both of you in this mode what happens. Okay, we'll define the modes also manually as well, and it takes automatically also. Okay, fine. So if you want to manually define the modes, you can define the quorum modes manually as well, and if you don't want to go for manually, so quorum automatically choose the mode as per the requirement as well. Okay, fine. So that's what we have, a first node majority. Okay, now second we have node and disk majority. Okay, node and disk majority. Over there also, we have one disk also in this. We have one disk and the same thing. And when more than 1/2 of the servers in the cluster are online. Okay, so what is the difference between this node majority and node and disk majority? It needs a disk witness also. Okay, now we have a voting option also is there. Means voting means, like, imagine that in node majority, node majority works on only the servers which you added in the cluster. So like imagine if you added 10 servers in the cluster, so we have 10 votes. So for running the cluster, we need 5 votes minimum. It means that your cluster should have at least 5 servers which is running. If less than 5 servers is running in out of 10 clusters, 10 server cluster, okay, so your cluster is automatically shut down. Okay. In second, node and disk majority, we need a disk also. So one disk is running over there. So one vote of disk witness is there. Okay. So one disk and the nodes also running over there. So if imagine my disk witness disk is down. Okay. So in that case also, sometimes my cluster is also down automatically. Okay. So it needs one disk and 1/2 of the servers are running on the cluster. Okay. Then the cluster is running. Okay, so this is what we have. Now number third, we have node and file share. Node and file share majority. Okay, so now if you talk about the node and file share majority, it needs at least one file share as witness. One file share as witness. And rest, It also works on more than 1/2. Same, more than 1/2 of the servers in the cluster are online. Okay, so it needs one file server as a witness, and more than 1/2 of the cluster is running. So that go for that. Okay, so that's what we have, three types of quorum modes we have. Okay, rest we have another type also is known as no disk majority. No majority disk only. No majority disk only. Okay, so in this cluster, in this kind type of quorum, as you can say that, it needs only a disk, a shared disk, as you can say that. Okay, one shared disk as witness. Okay. If the shared disk is offline, so the clusters automatically go down. Okay, it doesn't matter whether your server is running or not. Okay, in this kind of type of mode, it doesn't matter whether your server is down or not. Okay, it works on the disk. Okay, so if your disk is down, your cluster is automatically down. Okay, so like this we have. Okay, and the last one, the new one, is known as dynamic mode. Okay, it starts with November 2016 onwards. This is the new mode in Quorum. It's known as a dynamic modes. Dynamic Quorum, you can say that. We have a new Quorum named Dynamic Quorum. Okay, so in this Quorum, votes are dynamically assigned. Okay, votes are dynamically assigned. Okay, and it works as you can say that when half the votes are online. Okay, the same thing. Okay, so vote means the servers. We talk about the vote means the servers which is adding in the clusters. Okay, so dynamic quorum automatically define the votes. Okay, we're not able to define anything in that. It automatically define the votes. Okay, as per the requirement. So what type of clustering you are using? You are using the odd clustering or even clustering? We have a failover clustering. We have two things, odd or even. Like we have three node clustering or four node clustering. So these are the odd even clusterings we have. Okay, so dynamically quorum automatically defines the votes. If you using the odd clustering, so it defines the votes accordingly. If you configure the even clustering, it's requirement the it's defined there by their self. Okay, understood. Okay, like this. But that's what we have a quorum in this. Okay. Okay, so this is what we have, a failover clustering theory. Okay. Hello, understand these things, right? Sai, Teja and Teja, I hope you're able to understand this, the theoretical part of clustering, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now what we need as a practical knowledge, what we need, this is what we have, a network. Okay, so what kind of diagram we using, okay, in this. So we need at least three servers for this. Okay, so one server who becoming a SAN server. Okay, okay. Okay, so now we need a three servers like this. Okay, this is what we have, three servers. So we already have a DC and we have two member servers. So this is my DC, okay? And we have two member servers, which we already have, okay? Member one, okay? And we need member two server also. Okay, so we have two member servers. So now this DC is becoming a SAN server, okay? And I can attach one storage, okay? Attached one storage. Okay, this is the storage, as you can say that. Okay, I attach this storage with this DC, and this DC is becoming a SAN server like this. Okay, fine. And in member servers, I make this server as a file servers. So this is the file servers, as you can see that, file server one. Okay, and file server two. And in this file server one, I installed failover clustering. Okay, failover clustering services. And over there, I can install failover clustering over there. Okay, and after that, we'll connect this. These servers are connected with each other like this. Okay, and we'll define the storages. Like we configure the SAN server. With the help of SAN server, I can define the LUNs. Okay, to these servers. Okay, I can provide 10 GB LUNs to these servers. Okay, 5 GB for quorum and 5 GB for file server storage. Okay, same over there. 5 GB for storage and 5 GB for 5 GB for quorum. Okay, like this. Same over there also. 5 GB for storage and 5 GB for quorum. With the help of SAN, we can define the LUNs, the shared space. Okay, the LUNs, and then we can define the failover clustering, and then we can configure the failover clustering. Okay, so it's a bit practical, understood? Okay, so in next lecture, okay, I'll showing you how to configure failover clustering.